Let us now direct our attention to a major turning point in Jewish history, and that is the first Roman-Jewish war that occurred in the 60s and the early 70s of the first century. The spark that lit the explosion was something that happened in Caesarea, also pronounced Caesarea or Caesarea, which is a very important center on the coastline. We spoke about this city in the context of Herod the Great. It was a major Roman center during this period. Here you can see a map where it's located halfway roughly between Tel Aviv and Haifa in today's map. There are many factors that come together to create this first war, but perhaps one of the most significant general elements of the mood of the era was this dichotomy between the concept of the election of Israel and the disdain and neglect of a corrupt and bureaucratic Rome. On the one hand, there's no question that this first century was filled with messianic thoughts. We spoke quite a bit about it in the context of the movement of Christianity. Also, we spoke about it in the context of the Dead Sea Scrolls. There's a lot of people who are anticipating the arrival of the Messiah, which in Jewish thought is something that would happen with a great political upheaval, with a this world ruler who would initiate a period of freedom for the Jews in Israel, and then all kinds of other amazing things would happen. This is happening at the same time that Rome has let go of the reins of what's going on in Israel specifically. There's a lot of anarchy and banditry. There's a lot of lawlessness in the streets. They're not patrolling properly. They're not really caring what's going on because the Romans are engaged very heavily in their own self-serving grift, taking bribes and all kinds of things like that. There's also, as we will recall, Israel is never an area that is completely free of non-Jews. There are mixed populations in Israel, and not everyone there feels comfortable with the Jewish vision of what that land should be. It sounds familiar, right? This is basically the oldest story of that part of the world. And there are provocations that primarily come from the non-Jewish minorities in Yamnia and also later in Caesarea, as we shall see. In Yamnia, also known as Yavne, the local population specifically agitated to provoke Caligula into his disastrous decision to set up an idol to himself in the temple. It turned out, as we discussed earlier, that was short-lived because Caligula was assassinated. But nevertheless, there was a lot of friction between non-Jewish and Jewish populations in Israel. During this time, the combination of those two mood factors tended to push the Pharisees more in the direction of the Zealots, and there was a qualified sympathy for their desire to throw off the yoke of Rome. It was not a full-throated endorsement, but there was nevertheless more of a sense that the Zealots were towards the right side of history. And that was, as best we can tell, the mood of the Pharisees and the late 50s, and the people followed the Pharisees by and large. The spark that occurred in Caesarea was mundane. It had to do with a property dispute. It seems that Jews were renting a local space from a non-Jew for a synagogue, and they wanted to actually buy this space. The non-Jew did not want to sell to them. In fact, he wanted to evict them. The Jews must have had some kind of lease arrangement because they went and they petitioned the local procurator, Gessius Florus, who was known for his insensitivity to Jewish causes, who took their money with an agreement to hear their case and then promptly ignored it. So what ended up happening is on one particular Shabbat in the year 66, some local miscreant, it's not clear from Josephus whether it's the same person as the owner of the building, or perhaps someone who was involved in dispute, this individual went and performed a ritual idolatrous sacrifice of birds right at the entrance to the synagogue over an earthenware container in such a way, apparently he was aware of some of the laws of defilement, some of the complicated laws involving earthenware containers and defilement that are more complex than we can get into right here. But at any rate, it really enraged the local Jewish population of Caesarea. Some of the more hot-headed elements of the community actually rose up and began to riot, but they rapidly found that the mood of the local population in Caesarea, which was, again, recall, primarily a Roman-oriented city, not one of the more Jewish cities, what the tide of the rioting turned against them. What ended up happening is Gessius Florus turned a blind eye to this. He arrested the Jewish petitioners who had asked to buy the synagogue in the first place, and the rest of the Jewish community actually fled with their Torah scrolls to nearby Narbata. The news of the events in Caesarea soon reached Jerusalem with a much larger Jewish population, a much more religiously inclined population, and there was an uproar, as you can imagine. Gessius Florus, the procurator, sent troops to Jerusalem in order to try and quell the unrest, and while he was there, he actually seized a relatively small amount of money from the temple treasury, which certainly was a more incendiary action and was not going to calm down the population there. In fact, the local population even publicly walked around holding their hats out, begging for money on behalf of Gessius Florus to mock him. That certainly didn't improve relations between the procurator and the local Jewish population. But the violence got actually quite serious, especially in the upper city, and some people were killed. There was bloodshed, and the Antonia Fortress, which we'll see a little bit later, to the north of the Temple Mount, was actually isolated with the Roman troops imprisoned within. King Agrippa II, the Jewish king, who was actually not the king of Judea proper, he was really king of a region to the north. We spoke about him a little while ago. He attempted to calm things down and failed, and as a result, he fled to the north and avoided the bloodshed at this point. He would later actually end up participating in the war on the side of the Romans, but that's a little bit later. Menachem, the son of Judas, the Galilean, arrives. He was one of several zealot leaders who would compete for authority. And in this context of the upheaval, Elazar ben Hananiah suspended the sacrifice in honor of the emperor. And that essentially meant that the revolt was open. Up until this point, the Jews had always maintained a regular sacrifice in honor of the emperor. This goes all the way back to Cyrus, at least. And the idea of stopping this was extremely insulting to Rome, and this meant that it was open revolt. Now, there's some fascinating discussions of all these events in the Talmud as well, which add significant color to all of them. But for the time being, we're going to primarily present the Josephan account, and perhaps in another context, we can come back to the details that the Talmud offers as well. At this point, the local forces that the procurator was able to muster, a fairly small number of troops, could not handle the riot anymore. And so Cestius Gallus, who was the governor of Syria, and the region of Israel was within his supervisory map, he arrived with the Fulminata Legion, the 12th Legion. We're talking now about 20,000 soldiers. So he comes down from the north and he makes his way throughout the region until he gets to Jerusalem. Now we should remember that these legionnaires are professional trained soldiers. We're talking about maximum 23,000 rebels spread out throughout the entire region without discipline, without arms, without training. They had the advantage of knowing the terrain and they had the advantage of local contacts, but they were at a serious disadvantage when fighting actual troops. Nevertheless, they were so enraged that when Cestius Gallus entered Jerusalem, and he actually came into the city, he saw what kind of opposition he was facing, and he was intimidated by the Jewish rebels. He decided to retreat, and on his way back, he met disaster. Specifically, at a pass called Beit Horon. The Beit Horon Pass is a very narrow strip that requires essentially, you know, a couple of soldiers walking side by side as they make their way down this long pass. And the rebels were able to ambush them, and they actually wrought terrible havoc on Cestius Gallus's legion. They actually captured the eagle standard of the 12th Legion, which was a tremendous insult. It's kind of like capturing the flag, huge symbolic value. And they also, less symbolic value, but real value, they actually captured all of the Roman siege equipment, which would be very useful for them in the next couple of years of the war. Cestius Gallus actually survived the encounter at Beit Horon, but he was forced to limp back in a humiliating defeat, and this meant that Rome had to significantly accelerate their efforts. Next, we'll explore the second phase of the war, when Rome decides to send a much more battle-hardened general, Vespasian, along with considerably more troops to prosecute the war. Thank you very much for watching.